Morning, everybody. Good morning. That was pretty good for a small crowd today. Who had the toughest time getting here?
I did.
Yeah, right. Glad you admitted it. Good. We'll come dig you out later. Hey, I got a few announcements for you guys today. I'm Pastor Nick, by the way. They'll be on the calendar online if you ever want to check that. Go to wordoflifecma.org. We got all the stuff on the calendar out there. But I want to bring to your attention a few things. There's Men's Fight Club this Friday, March 15th at 10 p.m. That's to make sure you're committed. Right, Tony? He's, yeah, get you committed out there, get you up at 10 p.m. Take a nap earlier in the day, make it. It'll be all right. So there's Men's Fight Club. If you want to know more about that, talk to Tony right there in the Safety Clean thing, right? And he'll tell you what's up with that. Prime Timers, this is everybody that feels... older. Does that work? Sure. No. I feel old. I'll come too. They're having a movie March 16th on Saturday. What time is that? I don't have the time here. Does anybody know? The bulletin says 3? I don't have the bulletin. I'm sorry. But there's a movie on Saturday, March 16th, so check that out. Look in the bulletin. Next Sunday, there is a Life Conference 2019 lunch fundraiser. That's after service. We'll have some delicious food downstairs. We'll take a free will donation to send the 10 of us to Life. We got 10 now going, so we're gonna raise a lot of money. I'll have a total amount pretty soon here with some cool graphic to show you where we're at with raising that money. There's Ladies Art and Appetizers March 23rd. I believe that is the Sunday or the Saturday after this next one. I don't know what you guys are painting, but it'll be good because I've seen you guys paint those things before and they've been really good. So Ladies Art and Appetizers, they got to sign up for that. Do you know? This is all I got today. I'm sorry. Find out, talk to somebody, talk to Jamie, Rebecca. Yeah, talk to them. They'll tell you all about it. And then we got men's dinner. That's the last Tuesday of every month. Men's dinner is coming up March 26th for that. So there's your announcements. Again, look online. Sign up for the newsletter. Put yourself down on the card you have in your bulletin. If you have information you want to give us, a prayer request, or to get on that newsletter, let us know. I'm going to get us back into worship mode with Psalm 40. I'm going to read it for us today. This is Psalm 41 through 5. I waited patiently for the Lord. He inclined to me and heard my cry. He drew me up from the pit of destruction, out of the miry bog, and set my feet upon a rock, making my steps secure. He put a new song in my mouth, a song of praise to our God. Many will see and fear and put their trust in the Lord. Blessed is the man who makes the Lord his trust, who does not turn to the proud, to those who go astray after a lie. You have multiplied, O Lord, my God, your wondrous deeds and your thoughts towards us. None can compare with you. I will proclaim and tell of them, yet they are more than can be told. Guys, we have a good God that loves us. We can't even talk about all the stuff that he's done for us, all the good that he's done for us, and how much he loves us. So guys, let's continue to worship our God together. Let me pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can't even talk about all the good you've done. Father, how you've brought us up out of the pit. Father, you set our feet upon a rock. And Father, how much you just love us and are for us, and your thoughts and your actions are towards us, and we love you for that. Father, help us to think of those things as we sing today. Help us to remember your good deeds and your good works for us. And Father, help it to sink into our hearts so that we might feel it and know that you are God, and that we can put our trust in you. We thank you, Lord Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand this morning as we sing to the only one who is worthy of all honor, praise, and glory.
Romans 11, verses 33 to 36. Oh, the depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God! How unsearchable are his judgments and how inscrutable his ways! For who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor, or who has given a gift to him that he might be paid? For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be the glory forever. Amen.
Sing. Morning, church. My name is Halsey Stocker, and I'm an elder here, and I get to pray for the church this morning. I get to continue praying for the church this morning because the routine that Sundays are always a day where I pray for the church. So let's pray together. Father God, as we come before you, we come and I see that we have many prayer requests, and that's good because I know as a dad, I love it when my kids ask for something and I can fulfill what they ask for. And so I just think you are sitting waiting to hear from us so that you can spring into action. And we don't know what that action will be, but we know it will be, and that it will be in your love and your wisdom and in your strength, and we thank you for that even before we make the requests. This morning, I bring before you Lugene Flores. Her son passed away, and we just ask for your peace with her. I know that she's gone through many many struggles, and we just bring her before you and ask for you to be with her and to give us wisdom where you would have us interact as for you. We bring before you Mark and Denise Gray. We ask that you impact their lives, that you bring them your peace. And we bring before you Cindy Harris, my sister Cindy. I've been so blessed by working alongside her with youth ministry for so many years, and I just thank you for her wit and her wisdom and her caring. She's an inspiration, and I thank you for that. I pray for my friend Cal, as he goes to have surgery, that you would that you'd be there with the doctors, and that you would just give him a life without back pain. I ask that you would heal him up so that this summer he can get in the boat and we can go fishing again. I pray for Cole, for his friend Josh. Going through struggles is hard, and seeing you in struggles is sometimes hard, but you're there, and sometimes we can only see that once we get through the struggle, and I just pray that that you would be there, and that you would comfort and guide. Father God, I pray for Gary's son David, that you would continue to help his walk with Jesus, that you would bring peace to a father's mind, that he sees your hand with his boy. That is a blessing. I just ask you to bless Gary with that. Pray for Derek, that as he starts his walk with you, He sees you in it, and that you protect him from the distractions that can come of starting to follow you, and the trials and tribulations that can sometimes change the focus away from what we'd like to be. I pray for Andy, that you would give him your wisdom as to employment, and that you would give him peace of mind that you will be there. I pray for my friend Haley, who has a friend whose mother was in a car accident, and we would just ask that you would intercede in that situation and bring glory to yourself. We just trust in you, Lord. We pray for the upcoming Life Conference, that it will be an impactful time for our youth, that you will supply the resources. And Father God, I would ask for a special blessing on Nick as he prepares to lead this adventure for his kids, for your kids. Give him an abundance of energy, and just be with him and encourage him that he knows it is you that are with him, and that it's not something that he's doing, but that you're doing through him. I also get to pray up here this morning for the youth group, which is of special interest to me, I guess. I just ask that, first of all, that you give those of us who are working with the youth the patience that is needed and the openness that is needed. I pray specifically for my friend Conley in the youth group. And I ask for your connection with him so that I can show him who you are. We pray for all the upcoming events here at the church. We're busy people, but part of that busyness helps us to stay focused on you and not be distracted. I just ask that your spirit would be here with us as we gather together for these events, and that the time of fellowship would be pleasing to you. We pray for New Guinea, about as far away from here as you can get, and yet you're there too. Sometimes the width and stretch of your love is just amazing to me. And we pray that that you will intercede on behalf of what's going on there with their youth center, and that they would get a place where you would be shown to the kids. We pray for the workers there. Father God, as we continue on with our worship this morning, I just ask that you be here with us, that Holy Spirit moves among us, and that we that our ears are open for the message that you have for us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. As the offering plates are passed, please feel free to sing along or just listen. Ocean.
surpassing all the rest. It's an ocean full of blessing in the midst of every test. All the deep love of Jesus, mighty Savior, precious friend, you will bring us home to glory where your love will never end. Oh, the deep, deep love, all I need and trust is the deep, deep love of Jesus. Oh, the deep, deep love, all I need and trust is the deep, deep love of Jesus. Oh, the deep, deep love, all I need and trust is the deep, deep love of Jesus.
Well, it's good to see all of you here. I suspect in about 30 minutes we'll have some more people wandering in. We are in the book of Ephesians, so if you turn there. We are in the book of Ephesians, chapter 2. Starting with verse 11, I'm going to read a rather lengthy section of Scripture this morning, then we'll pray and dig in. Ephesians 2, starting with verse 11. Therefore remember that at one time you Gentiles in the flesh, called the uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision, which is made in the flesh by hands. Remember that you were at that time separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who were once far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who made us both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility by abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinances, that he might create in himself one new man in place of the two, so making peace, and might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. And he came and preached peace to you who were far off, and peace to those who were near. For through him we both have access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole structure, being joined together, grows into a holy temple in the Lord. In him, you also are being built together into a place for God by the Spirit. For this reason, I, Paul, a prisoner for Christ Jesus on behalf of you Gentiles, assuming that you have heard of the stewardship of God's grace that was given to me for you, how the mystery was made known to me by revelation, as I have written briefly. When you read this, you can perceive my insight into the mystery of Christ, which was not made known to the sons of men in other generations, as it has now been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. This mystery is that the Gentiles are fellow heirs, members of the same body, and partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. As we come to your word today, we know that you want to instruct us. We know that you want to teach us, that you want to remind us of things, that you want to bring new things to light, that you want to transform us. And so we soften our hearts before you, and we say, teach us, Lord. Teach us. Take us deeper in our relationship with you. Show us more of the glories of who you are and what you're doing and how you want us to be a part of it. I pray in the glorious name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. This is a big section of scripture that we're looking at, and we're taking a look at it over a number of weeks. Last week, we jumped in and we really focused in on the first word, which was therefore. And we asked, what's the therefore? And we realized that this section of scripture is a continuation of the first part of chapter 2. Where Paul had said that all of us, were dead in our sins. Dead, separated from God, in a place where we could not save ourselves. But God, by his grace, made us alive in Christ. That Jesus died on the cross for our sins, and now by faith in him, not because of any good thing we've done, simply by believing in him, we have been made new. We've been made new, transformed by the power of God at work in our midst. Paul made it certain that we understood. We can't boast about anything, because this is completely the work of God. Therefore, he says, remember that at one time you Gentiles were separated from Israel. And we scratched our heads and said, why is that a big deal? Why was that something that was so important that he had Paul write it down, and for 2,000 years it was copied and copied and copied and copied so that we would know it today? What was so important about that? And as we read through the passage, we realized that part of what's going on here is Paul is concerned about people taking pride, undue pride, in their upbringing. There's a sense in which God loves the different nations of the world. It's one of his purposes, is for there to be people of different cultural backgrounds, different ways of doing things, all worshiping him together. But there is an innate tendency in us to think that our culture is just a little bit better than the culture of someone else. My college roommate, for example, married a gal that loved her to pieces, but wow, she's different. She's different. I'm from a Scandinavian background. We were taught to count to 10. By that, I mean when you're having a conversation around the dinner table, when somebody's done talking, or you think they're done talking, you count to 10 just to make sure they're done before you say anything. Well, my college roommate married a gal who she just talked. Just talk, 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 talk. Well, I didn't understand her background till I went to the wedding and walked smack dab into my first New York Italian family where everybody was talking at once. It was so much fun, but I was so tired by the end of it. Well, which culture's better? Well, the tendency for me would be to think that my Norwegian culture is better, and her tendency would be to think that her New York Italian culture is better. And so we bring that into the church, or we bring that into our way of thinking, and we begin to think that somehow we're a little bit more, watch the term, righteous than the person next to us. And Paul, in this section of Scripture, blows that up. He blows that up and says, remember, Gentiles, you're the majority culture now. You think you have it all figured out. At one time, you had nothing. But Paul says that about his own culture in Philippians, too. And we sang about it. He said, whatever was to my profit, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. It's all garbage. And Paul's telling them this, and one of his goals is to try to create unity within the body of Christ, where we celebrate our differences, where we allow the differences to speak into one another's lives. For example, in my roommate's family, being New York Italians, they tend to speak what's on their mind. You know what they're thinking because it's coming out their mouth, generally speaking. In my Norwegian family, that ain't the case. That ain't the case. Well, maybe us Norwegians have something to learn from that Italian family. And we need to learn how to speak the truth in love, rather than holding it in all the time. Maybe there's something we need to learn there. And so as the cultures mix and bounce off one another within the church, we learn from one another and become more and more like Jesus. Okay? That was last week. That was last week. Today, I want to zero in on just one phrase in this passage. It says in verse 16 that Jesus wanted to reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility between us and God and between one another. Verse 17, and he came and preached peace to you who were far off and peace to those who were near. Verse 17, Jesus came and preached peace to you who were far off and preached to those who were near. And this is my question. When did Jesus preach to the Ephesians? He never went to Ephesus. He was never there. And yet, Paul says he came and preached to those who were near, the Jews, and to those who were far off, the Gentiles, the Ephesians, you who were far off. He says, Jesus came and preached to you. But we know that Jesus never went to Ephesus. So how did he, Jesus, do that? How did he do that? The answer is simple. He did it through his body, the church, the believers. He did it through his followers, preaching the gospel. He preached to those who were near, to the Jews, and to those who were far off, the Ephesians, through believers, through his followers. That's how we did it. That's how he did it. I want to jump to a passage of scripture where Paul really lays this out for us very clearly. If we take a look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Turn over to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. This is a passage of scripture where Paul says, look, we are ambassadors appointed by him to represent him. And he begins to lay out some of his thinking and what motivates his ambassadors. And as we look at this, we're going to see things which should motivate us as ambassadors. Let's dig in, starting with verse 10 of 2 Corinthians chapter 5. It says, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may receive what is due for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil. One of the things Paul says here is that is burned into his mind is the fact that all of us, everyone, is going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Everyone will stand before him. Think about that. The coworker that you sit next to is going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Your neighbor is going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Your grandson is going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ. And Paul told us in Ephesians that we are by nature children of wrath. There are no participation trophies given out just for being alive. The question is, are you holy or sinful? And the scripture tells us, that we're all sinful. And so the looming judgment seat of Christ should be something which weighs heavy on us. It should weigh heavy on us. That's where it begins. The understanding that there is a coming judgment. And it doesn't make any difference what your background is, what culture you're from. It doesn't give you any advantage when you stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Therefore, he goes on in verse 11, knowing the fear of the Lord, we persuade others. Understanding that there is a coming judgment motivates us to persuade others, to go out and talk to others. But what we are is known to God, and I hope it is known to your conscience. We are not commending ourselves to you again, but giving you cause to boast about us, so that we may be able to answer those who boast about outward appearance and not about what is in the heart. For if we are beside ourselves, it is for God. If we are in our right mind, it is for you. For the love of Christ controls us. Because we have concluded this, that one has died for all. Therefore, all have died. And he died for all, that those who live might no longer live for themselves, but for him who for their sake died and was raised. In light of the looming judgment, we have this sense of fear of the circumstances in which humanity finds itself. At the same time, the love of Christ controls us. The love of Christ compels us. What is that phrase, the love of Christ? What does it mean? It means two things. First of all, it means our love for Christ controls us. Jesus Christ died for people from the nations of the world. Jesus Christ died so that people might be saved. Jesus Christ died so that there would be multitudes gathered around his throne. The ancient Moravians sent missionaries around the world to win for the Lamb the reward for his suffering. So the love of Christ says, we don't want the love of Christ, his death, to be in vain. We want to spread the good news of the gospel so that as many as possible come into the kingdom. Our love for Christ motivates us to see as many gathered around the throne as possible. But the love of Christ also works in the other direction. Christ's love pours into our life. So we have the love of Christ so that we are motivated to action. Knowing that there's a coming judgment, the love of Christ motivates us to do something about it. There's a car accident. We're motivated to stop and help. We see somebody drowning. We're motivated to help. What can I do? How can I help this person? We don't stop and say, huh, I wonder what nationality they are. No. The love bursts over all those things. It says, I got to do something. I got to do something. In the same way, the love of Christ compels us to jump over all of those barriers. To say, no, this person is in need of salvation. So I'll cross those barriers. I'll cross those barriers. I don't want them to face the judgment of Christ without knowing Jesus. So I'll jump over the barriers. I'll risk the embarrassment. Because the love of Christ controls us. Verses 16 to 19. From now on, therefore, we regard no one according to the flesh. Even though we once regarded Christ according to the flesh, we regard him thus no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away, and behold, the new has come. Oh, this is such an important passage. This is such an important passage. Because all of us have a tendency to say, oh, I think this person is close. Just close to becoming a Christian. Paul says, no. I don't evaluate things that way anymore. I don't look at people and say, oh, this person's close and that person's far away. Oh, I'm going to share the gospel with this person because that person's safe. That person over there looks kind of scary. Okay? Now, this person looks open. This person looks closed. Paul says, no. I don't regard people that way. Why? Because salvation is a miracle of God in the heart of a person. It's the power of God, boom, blasting people open. And sometimes we have the angry neighbor on the one side who, you know, they're just mad about everything. And we have the nice neighbor on the other side who's just pleasant about everything that happens, you know. And we think, I need to share the gospel with my neighbor. Which way do we go? We go over to the pleasant person, don't we? It may be the person on this side is the one who is actually closest, who needs to hear the word of the gospel, and when they do, God brings a miracle in their heart. This person over here may be very closed to the gospel message. We have a hard time discerning that. And so Paul says, look, this is the way I look at the world. If anyone is in Christ, they are a new creation. They are a new creation. And anyone I meet has the possibility of becoming that new creation. Doesn't make any difference. Paul would say, look at me. I was persecuting the church. God changed my life. God did it. I remember being embarrassed one time, going to a Christian concert and running into my neighbor who lived several doors up the street. I was in college at the time. I was absolutely shocked to see him at this concert. I literally said, what are you doing here? Because he was, of all the people in my high school, the last one I would expect to see at a Christian concert. But God had touched his life. And he was radically on fire for Jesus. I wouldn't have had him on my list of people to talk to. But God changed his life. So we don't judge people by what our eyes see, but rather by what God could do. What can God do? It's huge. Verse 20. We'll start with verse 18, excuse me. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave to us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you, on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. We are his ambassadors. God makes his appeal through us. These ambassadors are not a special class of Christians. They're all of us. We are all his ambassadors. The question becomes, how good a job are we doing being his representative? Are we carrying the message of the king? Are we representing him to those around us? Those around us who are facing judgment. Are we doing our jobs or not? Are we reflecting well on who our King who has appointed us is? Being an ambassador for Jesus is the greatest adventure in the world. It is the greatest adventure in the world. Read the book of Acts and see the ambassadors at work. It's amazing what God does if we take the task seriously. You may say, well, I don't know what to say. Well, I have this to say to you, if that's where you're at. If you're saying, I'm an ambassador, but I don't know what to say, come to church an hour early, because we'll be talking about that in Sunday school next week. Okay? We'll be talking about that. We'll be talking about how do we do this with our friends, with our family, with our coworkers? How do we do this? We'll be talking about that starting 9 o'clock next Sunday. But remember, we are wall-leaping, division-jumping, fear-swallowing ambassadors of the Most High. What do I mean by fear-swallowing? It means we swallow our fear. We don't let fear stop us. We don't let fear stop us. You're afraid. Okay, you're afraid. Do it anyway. Do it anyway. Because Christ makes his appeal through us. Through us. No one is too young in the faith. No one is too old in the faith. Be an ambassador. Let's pray. Father, Father, as I stand here today, I want to thank you for sending your ambassadors into my life. For Sunday school teachers, for youth workers, for friends who didn't write me off, who were willing to share the gospel with me, who were willing to hold up the glories of who Jesus is to me. Thank you for them, Lord. Thank you so much. And Lord, I pray that we as believers gathered here might be that kind of person in the lives of others. We are your ambassadors, Lord. Lord, may we remember that anyone can be transformed by the power of the gospel. For it isn't us, it's you that is at work. And you are mighty to save. You are mighty to save. And we are your ambassadors, carrying that message of salvation. So send us, Lord. Send us in Jesus' name. Let's stand and sing about our God who's mighty to save. Send us from this place filled with your Spirit, empowered to be your ambassadors, authorized by you to share our testimony and the gospel wherever we go. Lord, we pray that as we share who you are with the people that we meet, lives would be transformed by the power of your Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Just a quick mention that there's going to be a brief meeting for the cast of the people who are in the Living Last Supper up here in just a few minutes. Other than that, you're released. Thanks for coming. You're my Savior.